Hi, my name is Wayne Dyer, and it's great to be here with you. I've been out doing this work for a very long time, about 40 years now, of giving lectures and writing books. And if you're new to the kind of teachings that I'm doing, welcome. It's great to have you here. In the last, 6 months or so of my life, I've just been having these very powerful callings. These are things that I've talked a lot about in my life, that callings. We all have them. We have these sort of interior inclinations about what we ought to do, these things that we call burning desires. I've been listening to them my whole life. I've written an entire book about all of those burning desires that impacted me. I Can See Clearly Now is the name of that book. And one of the things that I've been called to read was sent to me by an unknown person who thought that it would be something I could really benefit from. It was actually a book that Elvis Presley, believe it or not, carried around with him wherever he went. In fact, when he died, he had a copy of it with him, I'm told. The book is called The Impersonal Life. Just a small book. This is what it looks like. It was written in 1914, over 100 years ago. And it was written by a man who wouldn't give his name to it because he was a Lutheran minister. And he felt that the kind of teachings that he was offering in this book, which were really sort of a form of channeled writing. Now, I think all writing is channeled. I think it just all comes from the great impersonal universe that's out there in each and every one of us. Even these words that I'm saying now are words that I just allow to come to me. The man's name was Joseph Benner. He died in 1940, the year I was born. And when he passed away, his wife wanted to make sure that he was given credit for what had written, so she revealed that his name wasn't anonymous, but it was Joseph Benner, and he was a Lutheran minister from Akron, Ohio. And he received this information very much like the Course in Miracles or the Urantia book, some of the most significant books I've ever looked at in my life, and with great, great teachings, powerful teachings. This is just a book, it's just a couple hundred little pages, very short, and there's 18 chapters. And each of the chapters are written as if there were something within each and every one of us that he calls the impersonal life. He makes a distinction between our personal life, which is really basically our resume, and our senses, our five senses, what we can see, what we can touch, what we can hear, what we can feel, what we can smell. This is our personal life. My personal life is I'm 74 years old. I was born in 1940. I've written 45 books. I've done all of these things that, and each and every one of us has sort of a resume. And then there's the impersonal life. And the impersonal life, to understand the impersonal life is to really understand who you are. And most of us don't get it. We really are so connected to a belief that tells us that who I am is what my eyes tell me. William Blake had this wonderful poem. He said, "To see the world in a grain of sand and a heaven in a wild flower, to hold eternity in the palm of your hand and infinity in an hour, we are all led to believe a lie when we see with, not through the eye, which was born in a night to perish in a night, while the soul slept in beams of light." When you see with the eye rather than through the eye, we are really living a lie, because this part of us is something that comes and that it goes. But there's a part of us that is infinite, that is impersonal. The way I like to look at it is to take a look at my fingernails. I tell my audiences very frequently, just hold your fingers out in front of you and notice that you have 10 fingers. And say to your fingernails that are at the end of each one of these fingers, "I want you to stop growing tonight. I'd like you to just stop that. I'm tired of having to clip you. I've got to do all these little cuticles. There's so many things I have to do with you, and I'm just tired of it. I'd like you to stop growing." And you have a recognition that that's impossible, that there is an invisible intelligence, an impersonal intelligence that's with us at all times. But not only is this impersonal intelligence growing my fingernails, it's also growing yours. And it's growing every person's in the world. There's somewhere close to 7 billion people on our planet. And there are 70 billion fingers, give or take a few, that have been cut off. Or some people who have something called polydactyly, where they have 6 fingers on each hand. Let's say there's 70 billion fingers out there, and they're all being grown every single night. Yep. And throughout all of our entire time here on this planet, there's an intelligence that is connected to every single one of us. It's impersonal. And this impersonal intelligence is something that we need to listen to. And Joseph Benner, who wrote The Impersonal Life, spoke to us in 18 chapters as if this impersonal life were talking to each and every one of us. It is a message from the highest self within us, the part that is in all things, the part that opens all the flowers. There's a very famous quote by Rumi, who said, speaking about roses, he says, holding up a rose, he said, "What was said to the rose that made it open was said to me here in my heart when I met you." He was speaking about his recognition that this impersonal intelligence has many names. Back in 2005, when I turned 65, I wrote a book called Change Your Thoughts, Change Your Life. And it was basically about the Tao Te Ching, a book that was written 2,500 years ago. And for an entire year, I lived with the messages of the Tao Te Ching. And in the Tao, it says, the opening line of the Tao says, "The Tao that can be named is not the Tao." So they call this impersonal intelligence the Tao. Some call it divine mind. Some call it infinite consciousness. Some call it God. But it doesn't matter what you call it. It is something that is doing everything. Everything gets done. Everything gets taken care of. And it leaves nothing undone. You can't find it. You can't get a hold of it. You can't touch it. You can't grab it. And yet you carry this divine intelligence with you at all times. And we just don't listen to it enough. One of my favorite observations, I wrote it out just to talk to you a little bit about this. It says, if there is intelligence behind life, and there is every reason to believe that there must be, all of the greatest scientific minds on our planet say there is some kind of an intelligence behind life that we can't see or touch or feel, that opens the roses, keeps the planets in alignment, and grows our fingernails. Then all of that intelligence is innate in each creation of that intelligence. Thus, universal mind is complete and entire within each and every one of us. So all you have to do is discover for yourself its power and its perfection that is within you. It is something that you can consult. I was reading my friend Deepak Chopra's latest book. It's called The Future of God. And he has an observation, a quote in there that's very similar to what I just said. He said, if God is the creative source of everything, and God is in us, then therefore the creative source of everything must be in us. That we have within us this divine, impersonal intelligence that we sort of think that it's something that it's just outside of us, it's not within us. That God or source or divine mind is something out there doing something to us. But in the impersonal life, what I became aware of is how powerful this divine intelligence is. And when you connect to it, and when you begin to have an understanding and a realization of it, it becomes something you can do to change your entire life. One of the best ways to come to an understanding of this impersonal self that is with us at all times, the thing that is beating our heart and digesting our food and putting air, aspirating our lungs and growing our fingernails, is with an example of a clay pot. This beautiful clay pot was made for me by my daughter, Summer. Summer has not only the name Summer, but she also has my middle name, Wayne, because I never thought for a moment that I would have any more children after that. And of course, I had four more children after Summer, which I didn't know were coming. The invisible intelligence was working there as well. And so I take this clay pot and I ask you the question, what is it that constitutes a clay pot? What is it that makes this thing what it is? And you say, well, it's made up of all these minerals. It's got this paint on the outside of it that covers it up. It's been put into a kiln and it's been formed in such a way that it is now a clay pot made out of this clay that has been dried. I say, well, there must be something more that makes this than just the material. So my example is, if I were to take a hammer and I were to just hit this clay pot, So we would see that all of the material would still be there, the covering would be there, everything would be right there, but we still wouldn't have a clay pot, even though all the material is there. Because what we also need in order for this pot to exist is the space inside, the invisible space that's within it. And that invisible space is something that, if we don't have it, the pot can't exist. Now, if you just use the example of yourself as a clay pot and look at your own body, and your own body is made up of rivers of fluid, and it's made up of bones, and it's made up of skin, and it's made up of so many different chemicals in your body. And if we were to take your body, chop it up into a million pieces and lay there, all of the essence of who you are, the physical essence of who you are, would be there. But what would be missing would be the invisible intelligence within, divine intelligence, whatever. That, without that quiet, soft interiority, that impersonal, non-physical space within, this thing couldn't exist. And that invisible space is something that is within each and every one of us. So I was also directed to read a book called Vasistha's Yoga. And it's an ancient teaching that goes back 2,300 years ago. And in this teaching, Vasistha says that just as space is unconcerned with all of the clouds that manifest within it, so is the infinite intelligence, that invisibleness within us, that is something more than just the physicalness that makes us up, that is also infinite as well. When we recognize our own infinity, and we'll begin to understand that without the invisible space that's within each and every one of us, who we are doesn't exist at all. Who we are is just a bunch of bones and things. Not too long ago, two and a half years ago, my beautiful mother passed away. She was cremated. What they did is they handed us an urn. And this urn was a kind of a heavy urn, and it had all of these ashes within it, all of this dust. And it was my brother Jim was there with me, and my brother Dave, and the three of us, and they gave this to us. And I looked at this dust, and I said, surely this isn't mother. We can't think of that this is mother. I think about Emily Dickinson, the great poet from Massachusetts, the Belle of Amherst, she was called. She would say, holding up a handful of dust, this quiet dust was gentlemen and ladies and lads and girls, was laughter and ability and sighing and frocks and curls. Even Longfellow had this wonderful poem. He said, life is earnest, life is real, and the grave is not its goal. Dust thou art, to dust returneth, was not written of the soul. This thing called your soul, this interiority, this invisibleness, this space that makes anything existing, like this beautiful pot, it simply cannot exist without the invisible space within it, and neither can you. That interior invisible intelligence that is within each and every one of you is something that you must have in order to exist. One of the most important chapters in this little book that I read is called Finding Me. And you know, throughout the entire time that I was reading this book, and I read one chapter at a day, I've actually read this, I completed my eighth reading of this book. It's one of the treasures that I carry around with me. And I was reading a chapter called Finding Me, and it was a Friday morning. As I was reading it, I kept saying, okay, I know that this invisible intelligence is within me. I know something is growing my fingernails. I know that there's an infinite part of me. I know that. But how do I find it? How do I get in touch with it? How can I get a hold of it and grab it? And this was Friday morning. It was about 9 o'clock. And I was getting ready to go to the bank. And I go to the bank on Friday, and generally because my kids come to visit me, my kids like cash. You know, that's just one of the things that they're fond of. So when they come to visit me, I go to the bank and I get some cash for them. And every Friday when I go to the bank, there's a woman there at the bank, and she works as a teller. She has three children, a set of twins, and another little girl. And her husband has very serious diabetes, and She works as a teller, supporting all of them on Maui. So I was thinking, but whenever I go to the bank and I see her, I always put a couple of $100 underneath her keyboard there. And I always wonder, I hope this is okay that I'm doing this. I'm not sure if it's legal or not legal. I know there's cameras out there, but it's just something that I've been doing for a couple of years now. And when I'm going to the bank, I always want to make sure that that she is there, so that I don't miss her. Because I think after a while she's probably become dependent upon it. So I was finishing chapter 16, thinking I'll read chapter 17, but I want to go to the bank and I want to go. I don't know what time she's going to take a break, and sometime her lunch is later. And finally, I just said, forget it all. I'm just going to go now to make sure that I'm there. So I go to the bank and I meet and I see her, and I do exactly what I've been doing every week for as long as I can remember now. And on the way home, there's a woman who works at the dry cleaning plant, and she's very very sick. She's not very healthy, and she's got a very sick husband as well. She's considerably overweight, and she's just always in this hot sweat box kind of a place. And I usually just stop in there, say hello to her, and give her something, give her some money to just to help her out. She came to me one time and she said, when I gave that to her, she looked at me, she said, "Are you God?" And I said, "Guess what? Yes, dear, I am. And so are you. We're all God. That impersonal intelligence is in each and every one of us. We can just call it God or soul or spirit or Tao. It doesn't make any difference." So I did that. I drove all the way back, got back to my place, and I started and I picked up chapter 17 called Finding Me. And this is what it said. It said, "The best and the surest way you may know me is when selfless love fills your heart and there is a strong, compelling urge to help someone, to heal their ills, to relieve their suffering, to bring them happiness, to point out the true way. That is the actual feel of me within you, pushing the personality aside, pushing aside your resume and all of the things that you believe with your senses, but using your mind and your body for the purpose that I created them as avenues for the expression of my real nature, which is perfect love, the Christ of God, the one vitalizing, quickening, life-giving, strengthening, healing, all-supplying, all-informing power in the universe." That power in the universe, that impersonal self, it's talking to us all the time. I said at the beginning here that I had a calling, a burning desire to read this book because someone sent it to me. And people send me thousands of books, and most of them I have to give away to libraries and so on because I can't read them all. But somehow this is something I had to do. Vasistha's Yoga was sent to me, and I recognized that just as the space is unconcerned with the clouds that form in it, so is the infinite intelligence or the infinite consciousness from which we all manifest. It is unconcerned also with everything that manifests within it. And just remember, as you think about this, the clay pot. It couldn't exist without the interior space within, the silent, invisible space. And that invisible space doesn't need the clay in order for it to exist. And when this thing is over and it is done and what we call its death, the infinite intelligence or the space within it just continues on and on and on. What I want you to do is become aware of that divine intelligence, invisible that it is within you. It's always talking to you. It's got great messages for you. And every burning desire that you've ever had placed into your consciousness is something that is placed there, not by your personal self, not by your, because you can't get a hold of a desire. You can't see it. We can go inside your brain and we can find the command center, which allows you to have a thought that says, "I think I'll wiggle my finger," or anything else. But there's a commander in the command center that is your impersonal self. It is the divine intelligence, and it is always speaking to you and encouraging you and giving you callings. What you have to do is come to an understanding that it's there for you, it's always with you, and when you listen to it and begin to serve in the way that I spoke about, when I finally understood that because I had this desire not to get the cash, not to get to the bank, but to make sure that I could serve this lovely lady and the other lovely lady, that I've become dependent upon my ability to give them something each week. So I have created a whole series of free videos just for you. And the next one is going to be focused on I Am Light, something that each and every one of us carry around with us and we're not even aware of its power within us.